Hey there, viewers. Welcome back to the Self-Made Auto Channel. If you're new here, welcome to our channel. We've got a little fix for us today. We've got this 06 Chrysler Pacifica here. Came in the other day, and the lady said she had no AC, and I checked it out for her, and the problem is pretty obvious. It's got a big hole through the condenser here right in front of the radiator. So I've got a new one, and she brought it back, and we're going to change it. Like I said, it's got a pretty big hole in the front of it. Typically, the first step is pulling all the refrigerant off it, but I'm pretty sure we're past that point. So let's come over here on the low pressure side, and we can see, high pressure side. We can see it, just pushing in the Schrader valve, that the system is empty. So not too worried about that. I think I got to pull the whole front fascia off these things to do this. So it's about a 3-hour job. So we'll kind of see what's involved in that and go from there. I think first thing first, we got to start tearing some of this plastic stuff off the top and pop these headlights out. Kind of gives you some deja vu working on a Pacifica here. Makes me wonder if we should check ground 103, I think it was. One that's been featured in a couple other videos there. You guys are gonna go nuts when you see why this is this item has failed. It has failed because somebody did some shoddy work on the vehicle, and I'll show you why. I just looked down in here and I can see what happened. It's it's not funny, but just not sure why some people bother to do certain jobs if you're not gonna do the job right, you know. In a case like this, it's costing this lady a whole bunch of money because somebody did some crappy work. So, unfortunately, this car has been hit up here in this corner at some point. I see some evidence of some damage, so I don't know how easy this bumper cover is going to come off. I'll get these headlight assemblies out of here. This one's already broke. Nice. I know you guys like to check out all the New York corrosion. Lovely, huh? These folks live on a dirt road also, and you can see, just how much crap gets jammed in these cars, and you wonder why they rot out. I mean, this is all. You could probably sprinkle this on your steak if you wanted a little bit of salt. Because unfortunately, with the dirt roads, they spray calcium chloride on them year-round. In the winter to keep the ice off them, and in the summer to keep the dust down. So that's what it looks like. Not an uncommon sight here to see all that. Missing a bunch of screws here on the driver's side. strut bearings are so seized up on the other side. Wheel self-returns. Jeez. See the tire on end rear fall off over there too. Strut mounts broke. But we got AC. Underneath the car, looks like we just got unhooked the fog lights. Yeah, it looks like there's a bolt that comes down in the corner of this bumper cover from the top down, so we're gonna have to let the car back down and do that. And it appears some point throughout its life there must have been some push nail or, you know, the little plastic like we took out up top, these little push retainers. It looks like there may have been, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4 of them down here, which are all gone at this point. So I'm just gonna unhook the other fog light over here and we'll set it down and see if we can dig through the dirt and get to those bolts. This thing needs a whole lot of other work. There had to be something in there. Let me see what size that is. Looks like a 10. Yeah, it's a 10, but I'm gonna have to get an air ratchet, I guess. Well, I can see it's just pushing out on the corner of this bumper cover. I'll see if I can break it loose by hand first. Those J nuts or whatever they call them. Gonna have to try to pop the center fender out, see if I can't bite onto it with something, because you know what happens is it keeps spinning and it will eventually just, you know, just tear through the plastic. So see if I can't kind of pop this out, get a little bit of panther pee or something on this thing. Sprayed with some Freol. Had a viewer drop that off to me. So that's the best stuff in the world. Let's see if I can just spin it out with my fingers now that I've sprayed it with that. So, trying to snap onto it with a pair of ice grips here, but there's really not much to grab a hold of. That viewer also brought me some homemade jelly. So I trust him. I tell you. Just nothing to get a hold of here. I'll kind of show you what I'm doing once I get it out. Hopefully we get it out without causing any more damage here. I think we're ready for an air ratchet now. I should be able to get a hold of it enough to do this. Just didn't quite have the pizzazz that I need here. So now, bring in the big dog, see if we can get it fit in there.
She'll either go or blow now. Hopefully. Yeehaw!
Like I said, I just reached up in there with a pair of needle nose vice grips and the tin clip that this goes down into. Just hold that clip, keep it from rotating while we spin this nut out. Like I said, I'll show you what that, once we get the bumper cover, once we get it yanked off, I'll show you what I was doing. I guess I can kind of show you what I was fighting with right here. So it's just this this little metal clip. And like I say, my vice grips here. Just took a nice pair of needle nose vice grips, clipped it on from underneath. Of course, you've only got this little tiny edge to get a hold of underneath. And just kind of help hold that while you're taking that bolt out. And the problem is if you keep turning it, just with a regular ratchet or whatever, what it does, these things are so sharp, it'll just cut into the bumper cover and it'll come out here and it'll just cut a nice little hole and eventually the bolt will break and that's the end of the story. So I assume we're gonna have to do the same thing on the other side.
Oh, it's back in there somewheres.
The best thing to do is just try it by hand, but this side's a little more corroded, so I don't suspect it'll come apart any easier. Eat my words.
Ouch.
This one is coming apart easier. It feels like it broke free. That's good, because this fender liner over here isn't busted. The other side of the fender liner is busted, so I can just kind of peel it right back. Can't see what the heck's going on. Sorry if all you saw was my elbow, but we can see we got that bolt out. Let me show you why this AC condenser, so this is a training cooler here. This is the AC condenser here, the little radiator unit behind it, if you're not familiar with that. So what happened is some crackpot genius changed the cooling fan relay here, but in an effort to put money in his pocket and save time on flat rate, they put the new one right underneath the old one. Held the whole thing together with a zip tie. Well, the whole time this car is driving down the road, this little baby's swinging. Every time she accelerates, this thing comes back and whacks the AC condenser. And you can see back here, it's got a nice groove bore in it. This cooling fan relay just sits back here, swinging the whole time. And eventually it rubbed a hole through the condenser. All that in an effort to put money in somebody's pocket. So here it is, the AC condenser, the blower motor relay. So what we'll do is we'll take this blower relay and we'll do it the right way, this being that this was the root cause of the problem. Somebody never changed that. Did I say blower motor relay? Cooling fan relay, man. I'll have to cut that zip tie off, but yeah, cooling fan relay. So, like I say, it's supposed to be bolted to the back side of the bumper here, but it's not. That's what caused the problem. So, Can't do anything about it now other than fix it the right way. So I just want to show you guys that before I took apart. Of course, we'll get a closer look at this too. You know, you'll see where this cut in there once we take it apart. It's kind of frustrating because so many shops have such a bad name because they do stupid crap like that. But oh well. You know, I'm not griping about somebody making money on flat rate, but you know. A disservice to your customer by, you know, cutting a corner like that and doing something stupid, then you know, you kind of got to draw the line, because realistically you could pull this bumper cover off, pull the bumper off, change the relay the right way, and still make money. I mean, that's just what you can. Closer look at it now. So there it is, there's a little closer look at it, and you can see if the relay here was plugged in, or cooling fan module, or whatever you want to call it. You know, you can see it clearly is the culprit. Give you a little closer look at that. And this here bolts to the, or is pop riveted onto the bumper, the big aluminum bumper here. So looks like we gotta kind of expose this here. These rubber pieces come off each side about for the little push retainers, and it looks like the same thing on this side. That pretty much gets us out in the open. That's pretty good. That AC oil there, assume that's what it is. I don't think it's from the tranny. That kind of got all over everything here. Gonna make a little bit of a mess. Let's see. Mix it up with a little bit of dirt. I've got the ambient air temperature sensor here. Get that unplugged. Set that out of the way. So probably what we ought to do now, these looks like these training lines are got a flex hose in them. So I assume we're just gonna buzz the bolts off this sucker. Unhook our lines and 1-2 barbecue. Whoops, that one broke. That one came out. Looks like we got 2 out of 4. It really doesn't matter because this is going to come on the new condenser, so I wasn't too concerned about breaking those. Just so you know, set our training cooler to the side. Now, with that being said, these ones, they go into the radiator. So I'm going to kind of be a little more civil about taking these apart. We use some of the free all best stuff in the world, I'm told. That's a direct quote from a guy named Sean. Like I mentioned, he brought me some jelly, so him and I are tight now. Homemade jelly too, which I've ate most of. So I don't care if the bolt breaks. Behind her is an encapsulated nut, I guess, or a captured nut in the radiator. I just don't want it to turn that nut and break the plastic part of the radiator. I think it's just gonna break the bolt, to be honest with you. Like I said, I really don't care if it does, I just don't want it to break the radiator. Yeah, it's gotta be just breaking the bolt. I don't see anything turning back here. Oh, there she goes. Huh. Well, that turned a long ways before anything happened. Yeah, see, now it's starting to turn that nut. That's what we gotta be careful of. So I tell you what, I don't know if you guys can see that. Let me show you. So you can see the encapsulated, captured nut. I don't know what to call it. You know what I'm saying. It's a nut inside of the little plastic thing. As I turn it, you see how it's tweaking that radiator? Well, if you come back here and you get all hog wild, you know, you're gonna break that radiator. So I'm gonna try to give it some little extra rigid support here. Just wanna capture it just a little bit with a pair of needle nose vice grips. And I think probably the best thing to do is use an impact. And you'll think I'm silly for doing that, but it will give it a little bit of jiggle. And it's not as hard on them as actually pulling with a wrench. Boom, there it is. And we didn't break anything, that's the important part. So, like I say, if the bolt was to break, that's no big deal, because that's just like an old square nut. You can just take that out and slide in a, you know, if you're using a 6mm, or well, I guess this is an 8mm fastener, or a quarter inch, or whatever you have, you could just stick the nut back in there and be in business. So I think we gotta go do that on the other side and probably run into the same trouble. All right, so we're here on the other side. We give her a little spritz of the good stuff. Now it's turning, but I just don't like how they tweak on the radiator. It scares me. I don't wanna have to buy a radiator because I broke it. Some things are beyond your control, but this year we can do the absolute best to prevent a situation. And that one's out. Nothing broke. So we'll spray down our AC lines there. Let it soak for a half a second. So we can get these loose again. We don't care if these break because they're part of the old one here. And you wouldn't ever want to unhook those not knowing if your AC was discharged, because that would have got real ugly. No, our AC is discharged. Whoa! Get that off. Wonderful. There, keep from getting some crap in those anyways. We just gotta yank this thing off. There it is. Looks like the radiator's leaking a smidge too. Boy, when it rains it pours. So there it is, there's your rub hole. There's your AC condenser. All off, ready to go. See a little gooey up there in the corner of the radiator. Should probably have a new radiator. Ah, boy. Let's call and see what we want to do. Thank you. new one fits good.
Well, I guess because of the amount of other repairs that it needs, we're skipping radiator for right now. You know, this thing does, like I say, that strut mount's broke, the tie rod's bad, the subframe's rotted. But this is what it is, I guess. We're gonna do what we can do and keep moving on here. So I'm gonna tighten them bolts up. Grab my impact here. I put a little never seize on them, so if we ever, so when we do come back in here to change the radiator, eventually it'll come apart easier. I'm sure I'll be the next guy to, you know, have to take this mess apart, so might better make it a little bit easier on myself. Or if I'm not the next guy, it'll be easier for the next guy. So I think we just have to, gonna have to get some new bolts for these. These are threaded. Remember we broke off a couple bolts in there. So I'm gonna have to go upstairs, see if I got some bolts to thread, and I'll bring them down. We'll get this put back on. I'll get the rubber little grommets there going inside, get those put back on. I think that's where we left off. I don't know, I'd walk away. Just did a brake job on a Toyota Tundra here in the meantime. And got that done and did a couple inspections. So I'm trying to remember where we were leaving off here in the video. But I think we're on the right track anyways. Ah, shoot. I should have put a little, get some bolts ready here. I did have, they're just some 6x1.0 bolts there. And a couple of them. 16 millimeters long, so that way there, when we take this apart the second time, we don't have to have a, you know, a different size socket. They're still going to take a 10 millimeter wrench or socket or whatever you're using there. And that one's a little bit off, so these have those little J nuts or whatever you want to call them. Couldn't get that one started. It's just a touchdown. There we go. And I know you guys like to ask, this is a Denso condenser. This is the brand. Seems to be pretty good quality. These babies back on here. Can't put on yet. Jumped in the gun. We gotta put our lines on. Cool. So our O-rings, they appear to be in very, very good condition. There's no contamination on them at all. Let me see what they feel like. They feel great going in. I don't know, some people get pretty excited. You always, you know, always have to change O-rings. We're gonna take and throw a charge on it before we put this bumper cover and stuff back on. So I say, I mean, you can look across the plane of them and see that they clearly protrude past, you know, past the actual metal line. We're really careful not to get any contamination on them. Yeah, I mean, you can just feel them when they go in the housing. They feel good. I'm not worried about it.
I do have, it's not for lack of having new O-rings. I mean, I have a huge assortment of them, but I don't think it's really quite necessary at this point. So we'll just put these on and tighten them up. And then what we'll do is once we, you know, once we throw a charge on it, we'll take and just check these, make sure they're not leaking. And if they are, I'll just have wasted a bunch of time because I'll have to take it back apart and, you know, put new O-ring on it. But I'm, you know, done enough, you know, this little AC work to know that, you know, when they look good, you'll see. When they're bad, you know, they're square, you push them in, they just don't have, there's nothing there. So, you know, it's always a good idea too, I guess, if you're putting in O-rings, you can always put a little dab of PAG oil on there to make them, you know, make the assembly a little bit easier. But they're good and clean. They were still had like a little oily residue on them, so they went right in, no problem. And really, there's no need to, you know, flush this entire system. It just, you know, obviously the condenser ruptured, you know, just had created a slow leak until it finally just puked out all of its refrigerant and all of its oil. So it's not like we're dealing with any kind of, you know, catastrophic failure of you know, of the receiver dryer or the, you know, the compressor itself or anything of that nature. We don't have any system contamination that we know of. So throw this rubber back on. We're going to hook the vacuum pump to it, and we'll get this thing vacuumed out and get all the moisture out of the system and throw a charge on it. AC equipment here. Hook up a high pressure hose here, and then low pressure sides down here. Put it in a super convenient spot. Do is I'm going to turn on the vacuum pump, and what that's going to do is just reduce the, you know, the atmospheric pressure inside the system, you know, to like 30 inches of mercury, and that'll reduce the boiling point of water. So if there's any moisture in the system, basically it'll boil it off. Yeah, so I'm going to do that. That's going to be probably put a pull of vacuum on it for like an hour to make sure that we've got that good. And then we'll throw a little charge on it, we'll inject some oil into the condenser. A lot of times when you change a major component, you know, a receiver dryer or a compressor or a condenser or evaporator or something like that, usually there's a published amount of oil that the manufacturer will put out that they want you to put back in the system. So I'll look up that spec in the meantime, see if I can find that, and we'll take it from there. So I'll see you in an hour. So as the AC machine there, it's got the vacuum pump running, and I've got an hour to kill. I figured we could talk a little bit. And you know, a lot of people don't understand the theory of reducing the pressure inside the AC system to draw the moisture, to actually boil off the water or any moisture that's in there, to actually boil it off. And I would assume by boiling, we would, you know, another thing that we could say is, you know, the water is going to turn to vapor, you know, it's going to change states. You know, and often I think we refer to as, you know, a fluid that's boiling as, you know, hot, you know, I think it's 200 and some degrees, but by reducing the pressure inside there, you know, we decrease the boil point to, you know, room temperature, you know, 70 degrees or whatever it is. I'd have to look because there actually is a spec on that. But it's the exact opposite that we do with the radiators on our car. You know, we have a radiator cap on our pressure cap to increase the boil point so we can run these cars at, you know, 200 degrees without, you know, the water boiling over or, you know, or hotter. So just kind of something to think about. You know, sometimes we kind of disregard, you know, what the radiator cap does, or, you know, what pulling a vacuum on it does. So I got thinking, like, what's, you know, it's still kind of weird, like, yeah, is it boiling? So I've got a little thing here I just grabbed out of my, this little kit. You know, like your, my little Mighty Vac kit, your old vacuum pump thing there. So I figured we can kind of demonstrate this. Hopefully, can you guys see in there? Yeah, you can tell it's a liquid. So basically, I've just got some water. I went over to the sink and put some water in here. And I've got my old, I've had this thing forever, the old Mighty Vac pump. And I don't know if it's got enough go juice left in her to do this. But what we're going to do is I'll plug this in. We'll pull a vacuum on this. And theoretically, you know, it's probably 20, I don't know if this will go up to 30 inches. It probably won't. But around, like, you know, 25, 26 inches of mercury, we should see the water inside this container boil. Let me get my gauge. Let's see, we can see some bubbles just starting to form. I gotta try to get as much vacuum on it as I can. So you can see inside there that the water is actually starting to boil. And no, there's no air leak going in there to cause this. But each time that I pull, you know, as much, I've got 25, 26, 27 inches of vacuum on it right now. And you can see, you know, you can clearly see that the water is boiling, you know, or changing, stays changing to a, you know, to a gas. You know, eventually, if we continue to do this, the water would dissipate. And that's what we're doing inside the AC system right now. But I wish I had a little stronger vacuum pump to demonstrate this. But you can see in the tube here, it's actually starting to collect water vapor. So I know it's kind of a poor demonstration, but hopefully you get the concept. Try to. So yeah, I wish I had a clearer container to show you, but that's how that works. And that's, to the best of my understanding, is you know, what's going on right inside our AC system that we can't see. Granted, you know, hopefully there's not that much water in there or I'm in big trouble. But it's important that the inside of the AC system be you know, free of any moisture. So that's why they have, you know, receiver dryers or you know, things of that nature, little desiccant packs basically inside there to absorb any moisture. Hope that helped understand. I don't know if you could see, this thing's pretty cloudy. It's had brake fluid sucked through it and everything else. And the old pump here, you can see she's starting to get rusty, dripping water out of it now. So that's kind of a good example that it does start to boil off and pull moisture. And you can see the water coming out of the insides of it now. So that thing's probably junk. So thanks, YouTube. Thanks for ruining my vacuum pump for the sake of a demonstration. Not really, but that's that. Okay, enough rambling and babbling. Let's keep moving on. All right, one thing we can do while we're waiting is change this out. That's our original problem there. And that is our cooling fan relay, like I mentioned. So I'm just gonna take and we're gonna drill the rivet head off it and put the new one back on. Aluminum rivets, so they come out pretty easy. Get a hammer. Problem solved. Yeah, got that steel core in it. Oh, get all caveman on this thing. I don't know if a self-tapper will grip it, which in this case it won't. So we're gonna have to grab a bigger rivet and pop this thing together. All right, well, sadly enough, I don't have a rivet. I thought I had some window regulator rivets that were gonna be big enough for that, but I don't. So here's the option. We can take and just, it's got this locator on it. We'll just put it in the locator, and instead of having it here, we'll have it here. So, no big deal. Any place is going to be better
socket here. Any place gonna be better than swinging through the new core we just put in. So we're just gonna use a self-tapper. I thought that rivet's gonna be smaller, so my intention was just to use a, you know, self-tapper instead of busting out the big old honky rivet gun to pop that on. So we're gonna use this method anyways. Got the hole right where we need it. These self-tappers are also a self-drilling self-tapper. So we'll line that back up on there. Put that in. Make sure that's tight. So now we've got our cooling fan relay mounted up on the inside of the bumper like it's supposed to be. And that'll help this situation out here. This is the old one, must be has failed at some point in its life. Looks like it's got a lot of corrosion on it. All right, well, got about 4 minutes left, 3 minutes and some change. It's counting down. We've got the relay there all swapped over, and that's done, so that's good. I did look up the spec on this, and it does require 1 ounce of oil, it says. It says if the condenser is being replaced, to add 1 ounce of oil to the system. So we'll do that with this machine we have here. We can automatically inject oil while it's still under a vacuum, so we'll take care of that. We're just waiting for the time to get up here. And then we'll shoot some oil in it, we'll shoot some refrigerant in it, we'll verify that it's cold. We'll check these two joints out here for a leak, because that's the only connections that we messed with. And if they're good to go, then we'll throw the front end back on this thing and I give it back to this lady with the grocery list of other stuff it needs. Like I said, it's got a broken, this right front strut is broken. The whole mount's snapped right off it because the Chrysler made them out of pop metal. And the subframe has a rot hole through it. And the radiator's leaking. So, but they wanted AC. They got to be cool, man. And that's what we find. You know, we find that a lot here is... Boy, I've fixed the air conditioner on some pretty shady vehicles. I mean, this thing will come in, cars will come in, bald tires, no exhaust, you know, falling right in a heap. They want the AC fixed at whatever the cost. So it's kind of weird, some people's priorities on automotive repair. So I don't know if you guys see that where you work or not, or maybe you're like that as a customer, maybe you can elaborate why, but me, I'd rather have some good tires and brakes long before I had a, you know, working air conditioner. So, man, that's it. 2 minutes. I'm trying to kill some time here. Okay, so our time is up. We're going to inject some oil in it, or as I like to call it, Ninja Turtle slime. So, here's where we're at. We're about the 8 ounce mark. We're going to inject it down to the 7 ounce mark. Boop, just like that. And now we're gonna fill the appropriate amount of refrigerant and see if this works. So we wanna charge it at 1.81 pounds. And we're gonna charge it through the high side. Yep, we're ready to go. So here we go, we've already injected the oil and she's getting ready to blast it in there. You can hear it going in, and the AC machine here does a countdown, you know, has internal scales and all that stuff. So I don't know if you guys can see that on your screen or not, but I'll try to zoom in on that for you so you can see that process a little. This kind of weighs it all out for us as it's entering the system. Like I say, we're only charging it through the high side right now, which is good. This car's nice and cool, so we won't have any problems there. So. As soon as that's done, I'll kick the camera back on and we'll fire it up, throw our thermometer in it, see where we're at. It's pretty cool today. I've actually got the doors closed. It's like mid-July, and it was chilly this morning. It was only like 60. I think it got down to like 40-something last night, 48. It was cold, and we had a tornado. Pretty awesome. You don't see tornadoes much, at least in New York, but... Yeah, tornado, all of a sudden our phones blow up, you know, the big warnings and all that. Take shelter now. So me and Vanessa and, well, this boy Gavin, we were here, it's about 5 o'clock. So we hung out in the shop, concrete building, figured it'd
be better than driving down the road. But yeah, evidently there was like, you know, quarter size hail and all that stuff about 2 miles down the road, so the tornado just missed us evidently, but that's good. So all right, it's almost done. All right, well, that little guy's done filling up there. I guess before we get too far, we're gonna see if we have any refrigerant leaks there. So we're gonna use our leak detector. We'll just check around these connections. I think we're good there. It's triggered off, so it's pretty sensitive. If there was any leakage there, this thing would have went bananas. So we're gonna go ahead and start it up. Grab our thermometer and see how cold this thing gets. And, well, I just got thinking. We gotta have a cooling fan to make the AC work. So let's just set this on here. Kind of temporary. Plug it back in. That's plugged in. Whoa! Almost lost it. Let's take a couple bolts in it here. So we go flying. Now we'll start it up and see if the AC works. Center vent temperature about 38 degrees. That's pretty good. Nice and cool. Well, I guess that's pretty much it. Not much more to do. Start putting it back together the rest of the way. I think that was it. Our fog lights, our headlights. So yeah, we just gotta toss the bumper cover on. And we're pretty much done here, and that was pretty easy. So see if we can get some new push nails up underneath. I think, remember right in the beginning there, I was missing a few of those. And this car obviously ain't no virgin. I see she's got some overspray. It's pretty obvious it's been hitting this front corner. It's got paint all over it. And this filler piece is busted out. But it ain't your first picnic, so let's keep going. Gonna put these bolts back in that inner fender, grab some anti-seize here, and we'll slip them in, so hopefully they don't fight us next time. Okay, all we got left, I think, is the headlight. We'll button up a few things underneath, get our fog lights plugged in, all that stuff, and we'll be done. There it is. There's the phone again. So I found some plastic retainers we can stick back in these holes, kind of hold the bottom of this bumper cover together. Over there, when I gotta do the radiator, I could break them. These things sometimes can be real tough to get out, you know. Crusty on the old subframe. These Pacificas are pretty noted for this. This little cross member here rust out, but not a huge deal. I changed a bunch of them. We get them from down south, and they actually had a recall on them. I thought they were paying for them for a while. Tell you what, that strut bearing, man, that thing is seized up tight. Well, the strut actually, because it's busted. Must make driving this thing real chore. That's it. Car's all done. Took it for a little drive. Got one word. Chilly. It's cold. It blows nice and cold. Customer will be super happy. Well, they'll be super happy their AC's cold. They're not going to be super happy with the rest of the story, but that's the way it is. Subframe's toast. Well, it's not toast. It's fixable. You know, same thing for the strut. Yeah, it's broke, but it's fixable. And same goes for the radiator. You know, yeah, it'd been nice to put a radiator in it today, but money doesn't grow on trees, so we can't, you know, make anybody do something they don't want to do, and that's a fact of life. So I hope you learned a little something. Maybe you learned how water can boil at a reduced pressure, and you know why we put a vacuum on an AC system, or you know, if you've heard that terminology before, you know, you got to put it under a vacuum. Well, that's why. So I hope that demonstration worked good. Let's see, what else did we learn? Oh, those little C-clip or little U-nuts, whatever you want to call them, how to take those off if they start to twirl around on you. And we learned that sometimes taking a shortcut might be a short-term gain, a long-term loss. But, you know, whether that blower fan or that cooling fan relay was put in by a DIYer or even by a professional, you know, mechanic or technician, whatever you want to call them, you know, cut corners isn't always the best. Now, yeah, you could have done that without, you know, pulling it all apart and you know, bolting it on, even though it's pretty easy to pull the bumper cover off. You know, you certainly could have zip tied it in a little better position than it was, you know, so it wasn't sitting there and just swinging around. And I guess, man, just if you're gonna do something, if you're gonna, you know, cut a corner or, you know, save a little bit of time, just, you know, be respectful to the owner or even your own car, and kind of look at what the long-term consequences might be if you you know, choose to take that action. So I guess that's it. Another thing you guys always ask about is the tools that I use, and I always forget at the end of the video, like, oh, they want to see your tools, or they want to see what you use. So I do have some neat things I do want to show you real quick. So again, I get asked all the time, like I say, what, you know, you Snap-on guy, you mat guy. I'm not at anything. I use a lot of stuff. I use everything. I use everything from some Wing Wang, just crapo stuff, to Snap-on, Mac, Lyle, Craftsman. I use it all. But one thing I have run across, and this was introduced me. A guy sent me this. This guy I know, who I know now, sent me this Top Tool Impact. He got it as a gift. He gave it to me as a gift. Likes watching my channel. I never heard of this brand. It's Top Tool. That's the brand of it. That's what's on the side of it, that Top Tool, I guess that's how you pronounce it. So he sends this to me, you know, whatever. So I start using this thing. This thing is an animal. I mean, it's like ridiculous. And, you know, it's almost silly. It almost makes me smile. It does make me smile when I use it, because it's small, but I call it the destroyer. It is nasty. It's heavy, super heavy. I don't know what it's made out of. Tungsten or something. I don't know. It's heavy. So anyhow, that kind of got me interested a little bit in these top tool because it's obviously made, I mean, of course, I abuse the crap out of my tools too, in the sense that I just, you know, I don't take every day and wipe it and love it and hug it. You know, I use them and I throw them in my toolbox and I use them again and then, you know, I wipe them off like when I'm making a video and I want gotta have something to do with my hands. So anyhow, it got me interested a little bit in this top tool company, so looking at it, you know, come find out this guy, I'm sure he'll comment on the video below about top tool. And so I started looking at their stuff. They've got screwdrivers, it's upside down, these top tool screwdrivers. So I started buying some things because curiosity got the best of me. And I kind of went hog wild buying some of their stuff because it's very inexpensive. And that's the part that baffles me, is it's inexpensive, but it's super good quality. Of course, I've held all kinds of different tools, you know, different sockets and stuff. And, you know, you can tell when something's junk, but I actually bought, let me dig out of my drawer here. I bought some of their impact sockets because they're cheap. And I bought, I actually swapped out my Mac sockets for their chrome sockets. They got a neat little satin finish on them. And I'm not trying to turn this into a tool review or anything like that, but they make some outstanding products. And one thing that, you know, sockets are usually sockets, but they're really good. I'll say that. And what else? Oh, I was gonna show you one of the wrenches I used in the video, because these are cool. Because anytime you buy a wrench that's, you know, quote, inexpensive, usually they're about this long and you can't do anything with them. But I bought this set here, which was, I'd have to look back to see how much they were. But it's these extra long metrics. And these things are ridiculous. So I was using a 13, and you can see how long it is. I mean, this thing's pretty, you know, pretty good size compared to a 13, a normal 13. And they're wonderful. When I first got it, I was super skeptical. I'm like, you know, they're thin, they're lightweight. But like when you drag a file across, you can tell these are made of some like really good quality metal. Can't make it ding. You don't hang on to it with your big meat nugget fingers. Ding, it's got a nice ding to it. I don't know if that means anything. But no, they're great quality. I mean, look at this thing, that's a 19. Thing's jumbo. So these super long wrenches, they got all kinds of stuff. I just went silly. Got their vice grips. And I'm usually like this huge Irwin vice grip only fan. But Irwin is sold out. It's so sad. You can't even get a pair of vice grips made in the USA anymore. Isn't that disgusting? So I got these top tool vice grips. And I've been using these. These are the ones I was just using in the video. That's kind of what reminded me of it as I was taking care of stuff that I should show you this, guys, because maybe you haven't heard of this brand. Because I certainly hadn't. And anyhow, that's enough. That's enough rambling. These things are cool. They got so much stuff. Even that screwdriver bit I was just using, that magnetic screwdriver bit, the thing looks weird, but it works outstanding. I don't know. And I bought these socket angle or offset angle wrenches, or whatever they call them, because I just thought they looked wild. It is the handiest thing I've run across. The set's weird though. When you buy it, it doesn't come with a 15. Fortunately, when he puts these together, the 15 comes with it. It's not sewn into this bag, but I mean, I don't get it. I still don't know why this stuff is so cheap, but it is, and I'm probably gonna purchase some more of it. They've got some neat stuff, but yeah, that's it. So anyhow, enough rambling about the top tool and different tools. And I think everything else in the video was pretty standard. AC machine, I don't know what it is, Robinair. Anyhow, I'm sure the guy will comment in the box below as to where you could inquire about your top tools and what's out there, but there's definitely certain things that I could vouch for on them if you're interested and you're looking for some inexpensive tools, but tools of an extremely high quality. It usually doesn't go hand in hand. I don't get it, but I'm gonna take advantage of it. So I guess that's it. So with that being said, we'll just wrap this video up. So thanks for watching. I hope you understand a little bit more on how to change an AC condenser in a Pacifica. We've had a couple of Pacificas in, it all had some bizarre problems, and it looks like this one's gonna be coming back with some more fixes. So that's it, viewers. Thanks for watching, and remember, if I can do it, you can do it.